this very instant, a monumental change is occurring in the marketing industry. Tomorrow will be nothing like what we saw yesterday. What does this future have in store for us? What needs to be done today to stay ahead of the curve tomorrow? This is my quest to find answers to questions that have never been asked before. This is where India's leading marketeers share their perspective on issues that challenge entire industries. This is The Leap. Welcome, Arvind. Welcome to the show. It's been a dream for me to actually come and sit across to you and discuss so many of the conversations that we've had offline. And, you know, one of the things that I've gleaned from our conversations is that there is a rich amount of experience that you have in doing some things that nobody could have really thought of. There have been genuine disruptions. There have been genuine game changers. They have impacted the country. They have impacted business. They have impacted marketing. And I think those conversations is important for us to give that perspective out to the people as well. Let me start with a question which I'm sure a lot of people have asked you. You know, almost a decade and a half back, you were working in Silicon Valley. At that point of time, why would you come back to India?
So Jatin, first of all, thank you for having me here. You know, our experience is such that unless we share it, we don't empower the next generations to learn from it. And I think a lot of that you've asked me, the motivation lies in public good. The fact we're doing this interview, probably millions and millions of people will see this and maybe they'll take away something and they'll learn from it. And that's how I have learned in my life from others. So you're talking about Silicon Valley and then moving back to India. I was seeing a lot of talk in the valley, but no execution. A lot of talk in the valley of catering to the top 1 billion, the creamy layer, I always call it, globally. But who's going to cater to the 6 billion? That is not the creamy layer. And I think my motivation has been for very long that we need to produce innovation and products from India, which can disrupt the world, not only just India.
Fantastic. So today, Arvind, you're wearing multiple hats. You're a technologist. You're impacting public policy. You're impacting governance. You are impacting startups. You're impacting a lot of the business community as well. You know, you're also an angel investor. You're serving on the board of a few companies. How are you wearing so many hats?
I think that's the biggest challenge in life now is to be able to, I mean, there are two approaches. I've probably taken this approach is to be able to diversify myself so that I can do a little bit of everything. I think I've come to a stage where I want to make sure that I can mentor people, I can share my experience, advise them correctly, and share knowledge. And that has to be spread out. And I think that makes me both invest and discuss multiple things. But core of it also lies disruption in India. All the my angel investments are companies that are disrupting the Bharat, not just digital India, but the digital Bharat. They have a mass impact on the quality of life of people outside urban cities. And that's my motivation, because that's where the frugal innovation, the make in India innovation lies. So you have to wear those multiple hats. And without saying it goes that, you know, startups, you need to have 6-7 startups. I mean, you'll be lucky if 1 out of 6-7 succeeds. In 2010, I left this office where you're sitting right now and interviewing me, and went to a small office, a small cubicle in the BJP office, 9th of July, 2010, to say, okay, let's take on this battle called, digitizing and BJP.
In 2010, you know, we lived in a very different world. You know, it's very difficult to imagine that one could, you know, look into 2014 and say that what actually happened would happen.
You know, I have to say this, the conviction of execution lies. You know, we have to do our karma. I was very sure if we do the processes right, we will have an edge, right? Yeah. But, you know, we were blessed to have a great right amount of the best product that we could market. But at the end of the day, we set the right systems in place. right process in place, and I had the wrong conviction. It's easy to join a winning brigade.
But what got you into it?
Well, the motivation to change. I mean, if you see the impact that you can make by going digital and using social media and data for elections, it's humongous. I mean, I was laughed out of TV rooms in 2012 and 13 when I said that this election, one third of the seats, 160, 170 seats, will be impacted by social media. Yeah. People said, these guys don't vote, they're trolls. Yeah. It took a lot of conviction to say, no, they are real people and they do go out and vote. And I need an audience and I'm going to talk to this audience.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So, you know, it takes conviction, it takes execution. And of course, a lot of good product and a good leadership in the party, which blessed you, which said, you know, go ahead and do it. There's a lot of trust.
Yeah. So, Arvind, two questions. Who got you into this entire movement on public policy and governance? Is there a story there?
Jatin, the reason is that I believed that center-right policies in India, center-right economics in India needed a space. And somebody needed to run a very organized campaign to make that happen, to win. If you don't win elections, you can't impact anything, right? And in politics, there's no price for coming second. So we had to organize a plan, as I said. But as I said, we also had great leadership at that point in time. The party was transitioning into a new set of leaders, Mr. Gadkari, Mr. Jaitley, Mr. Piyush Goyal.
Right.
All that we did in the first 3 years was increase the circle of influence.
Right.
Because elections is all about numbers.
Yeah.
And numbers with a lot of data, right? I mean, where we need to increase the circle of influence.
And in 2010, you knew that this circle of influence will get influenced through digital.
One of the things, and I said that there will be 160 seats where digital will play the top 3 role.
Yeah.
There will be another 200 seats where digital will play the top 10 role. And beyond that, probably not in that election. It's all going to change next election.
That's fantastic. So was that predicated on the success of the Obama campaign in 2008?
Any campaign in the US speaks one language. Right? Literacy levels, connectivity levels, media awareness levels is all practically the same. India, you have 14 different languages, plus 8 another official, 22 different languages. You have different literacy levels. You have different penetrations of media. I mean, today's hyper-connected consumer is not the hyper-connected consumer of 2011 and 12. So, India is a very diverse market. And no electricity sometimes, no power.
No internet sometimes.
No internet sometimes. You still have to communicate to that because that person will go and vote. So I think all parallels are wrong. Plus, understand Indian election happens in 7 phases. So you're running a campaign after campaign after campaign.
Right.
There are parts of India where which are so remote.
Yeah.
And we went and campaigned, put our ads and marketing out in Ladakh and Leh region, and we won that by 35 votes. So every vote counts. And that was the fundamental of our campaign. So multiple languages, there is the scale of India, the speed of India is probably a benchmark today, not the other way around.
Yeah.
So let's talk about, your journey. You've already said that 160 seats is what you were trying to impact through social media or digital media. One, how did you come up with this number? Two, was there a framework? What was the thought process in creating a strategy to impact these people?
Oh, very, that's a very good question. First of all, we did both a lot of primary and secondary data collection down to the booth level and aggregated data. This is not only a digital election, the social election. It's also a data-driven election. And I think that's where the lesson for any marketeer lies. You cannot ignore any data point, any medium.
Yeah.
So we designed a campaign which was 360 degrees, data, digital, mobile, social, everything, on ground of course, technology like 3D, so everything combined worked together, and that's the beauty of the campaign, and that's why I say that it is unparalleled today. I used to have a small saying outside my office, a small little office. It used to say, "In God we trust, the rest everybody bring data," because one big thing I'm finding, and that is true for marketers, that's true for organizations, for businesses, they don't have truthful data. And that is where marketers go wrong. They try to believe data, that they want to believe. And believe me, as a data analyst, I can tell you something. You can make data sing and dance to your tunes.
Yeah.
To make it independent and assess it, you know, and analyze it independently is the key for a success of a campaign. And that's what we did.
And there's a lot of discussion today about, you know, hyper-local targeting, hyper-local marketing and so on. And it seems to me you did that in 2014.
Absolutely.
If you're saying 130 seats out of 160, that means that you were going down to the booth level.
Absolutely.
You were going district to district, and you were impacting people's perception about what you stood for.
And communicating in a language that they understand, in an issue that they understood.
Yeah.
Say, issue in East Delhi is different than issue in Central Delhi.
Yeah.
If you give them a mass message, it's not going to fly. Yeah. Where marketers nirvana is, I always joke about this, is that this one-to-one marketing. We didn't do one-to-one, but we did one to probably 1,000. But as personalized as possible. And that's where the future lies.
That's incredible, because even today, almost every company are probably trying to figure out three things, right? How do I go more hyper-local? How do I do localized marketing? How do I do native language or regional language marketing? And how do I do one-to-one, or at least 1-to-100 or 1-to-1,000? And it seems to me that you did all of that in 2014.
We solved this in 2013-14.
Digital to me, going digital, going social, is actually very good for democracies and for marketing campaigns, both. Because number one, it's attributable. Right, you know what the KRAs, the KPIs are measurable.
Right.
And two, the very important thing is it cuts down the overall cost of campaigning. So our wasteful expenditure will go down.
If there is, for example, news on demonetization, which just came out a couple of days back. Now, just like we discussed right now, data can be interpreted in two ways.
Absolutely.
There can be an interpretation saying demonetization worked. There can be an interpretation which says demonetization did not work, and a certain section of media will pick up on both. Now, depending on where you are and who you are, you might be consuming a certain section of media, and for you it might just say demonetization did not work, right? Because of that media coverage or media consumption that you're having at that point of time. Does being available, accessible, transparent allow you to be more answerable, or does it make you a little too answerable at times?
Well, number one, there's nothing called too answerable. Engagement and answerability and transparency in data is very, very important. I mean, you give an example of demonetization. See, I always believe this is an age of information war. You have to counter wrong information with correct information. And if you're doing a bad job of giving out correct perspective, the person who's peddling wrong information will win.
Yeah.
So it's your job to peddle the right information and what you feel is right also.
Yeah.
So I think this is an information age, and we need to manage the bad information with correct information. Yeah. And it happens all the time.
The Supreme Court has recently passed an order which says that right to privacy is a fundamental right. Now, I was speaking to a group of executives from the US, from Silicon Valley and New York, and asked them what your biggest fear is. If that were to come true, you would lose your sleep. And I was stunned to know that they said, if my consumer got to know how much we know about them, and were they to switch off that stream of data, it would make them lose their sleep. So how do you view privacy? Are consumers sharing too much? Do marketers know too much? How do you view the entire paradigm? Yeah.
What happens is that we trade our privacy for a free app.
Yeah.
We trade our data with free app. And that, I think, a mindset change in the hyper-connected consumer also has to happen. Because today we just click yes, yes, yes to any terms of service. We just keep downloading apps, don't like one. And there's so many the apps today are reading so much data, so many locations, so many different features on our phone. So the real question is, who owns the data on our phone? Consumers or the apps or the platforms or the phones?
But as public policy, how do you help the consumer? Because a lot of consumers...
Now that is your question, and I've been saying it for last 1 year or 2 years, that we need to have the framework for data privacy, data sharing, data security.
Yeah.
And the Supreme Court verdict is going to just accelerate the process. They've recognized that the government has set up a committee,
yeah,
which will look at how data gets used and shared, not only of local apps or international apps, everybody.
I think it's really important, absolutely.
And I think for long,
yeah,
you know, opt-in into X service has been used to do Y, Z, A, B, C, D, E. And the terms of service keep getting changed upon us. And because we've got hooked onto the app, we had no other recourse.
Yeah.
Or we have started using a service so much that we can't get off. And because of uneven flow of capital, the local market has not been developed so much. So we are totally dependent on that service.
Right.
So I think there are a host of issues that, right, as a country, we'll have to do that.
Right.
I'm just glad that the right set of people who understand the value of this are leading this country, are leading these discussions, and I hope something good comes out of it.
Where does the future? So let's talk about privacy in 2020. What will happen?
See, 3 years from now, what I forecast, my view is, already we have 20 billion devices connected to the internet. Probably in 3 years, this number is going to go to 75 to 80 billion. You know, Moore's law is going to be applicable,
yeah,
even more.
Yeah.
And India is itself going to do, you know, a billion connected consumers,
yeah,
hyper-connected consumers. I think the world is reaching a stage that we are producing enough real-time data,
yeah,
combined with artificial intelligence, yeah, machine learning, and the concepts of cloud computing,
yeah,
all combined.
Yeah.
I think AI will really be a very, very important thing going into the forward. It's really the cross section of AI and data that we are going to see today. So
yeah,
people who control data,
yeah,
people who control the algorithms, will rule a lot of things, a lot of businesses, a lot of countries, a lot,
yeah,
of everything else.
And I think that's where the concern is as well, right? Because if you look at Amazon, Google, Facebook,
Apple,
Microsoft, you know, for them, the biggest focus right now is AI. We know that with the amount of connected devices that we will have, the amount of data and machine learning that it will affect, we'll just, you know, AI will be fantastic. It'll be a comfortable, more comfortable world. But at the end of the day, that's your personal data.
Well, that is exactly where the data privacy, data security rules will come into play. What you share, what it can be used for. And if I asked you to understand my health data,
yeah,
and give me a bot giving a recommendation,
yeah, yeah,
based on similar people globally,
yeah,
then I have to know exactly who's getting it,
yeah,
what is the life of that data, and who else will use it.
Yeah.
And I should have either consent-based architectures or access-based, I mean, you can keep debating that, but I should define who all controls it. And if some unauthorized people control access the data, I should get alerts. So
yeah,
there is going to be a lot of paradigm shift in how data is used and then monetized.
And do you see companies helping you out in that, or companies agreeing to do this?
They will have no choice. I mean, the companies need to, I mean, they see, also it goes without saying that entrepreneurship develops in gray areas,
yeah,
and policy never can keep up with technology,
right,
but now we have a clear direction,
yeah,
from the Supreme Court, and hopefully there's going to be a clear direction from the Parliament. I think companies will have to abide by that. After all, it's India, and India produces the highest amount of this new age oil. I'm going to also make a very bold statement for 2020, now that you asked, that I think marketers are going to become irrelevant. If they don't, there's an if there, if they don't understand the convergence of technology, digital, data, and machine learning, right? And this is very important. I think marketers still are operating in their own silos. I've always said it, the office of the CIO, the CTO, the CDO, CMO, all needs to converge into one office. And that's your primary office. And that person with that skill set is going to be really the right skill set going into the future.
Arvind, you're also right now working on digital BJP. What does digital BJP mean? What will it do? And how will it help?
See, what we want to do is make sure we are a completely digital first party. From the 400 district offices that we want to set up, real-time communication, activities, events are being posted at a larger scale, and which can be analyzed and stored for the future and be used when there is need to do that. So that's the whole project. I think, as I said, and I can keep repeating that, the next election is two-thirds digital. And we have to get that. And people who invest in it, not only just physical infrastructure, but people infrastructure, training infrastructure, the classic people process technology, will benefit.
Give us three tips that a CMO / CDO or whoever that executive will be
in 2020.
Manning, you know, because I mean, indeed, digital is a confluence of customers, internal employees, employer advocacy, being able to build an employer brand, customer service. So it's a confluence of multiple verticals in an organization. We don't know what that role will look like, or maybe we do. If you had to give three or four tips to the leader of the future.
See, I think it's very important, and I keep saying that it's you have to have the right teams and right people, both inwards and your ambassadors outside. People are the key. Driven by the right set of tool sets, which is data and digital. Without that, you can't win anything. And unbiased data, executed digitally. So, you know, the world will keep changing every 3 years, 4 years. I always say Moore's law has disrupted itself. It was 18 months, now it's 12 months.
Yeah.
So we don't know where it's going to go. But these fundamental things of the right people, having a huge set of data, and using the right technology will not go out of vogue. So those are the key things that people need to be on the edge.
Right.
I somewhere feel that people work in their silos. Data will be the biggest silo breaker.
Yeah.
And companies which recognize that will benefit a lot.
I loved your quote, you know, where he said, and I'll actually read out, that there's this keyword called big data. And you said this in 2014, which I find very interesting. Everyone is talking about it. I think it's like teenage sex. People are talking a lot about it, but no one actually knows what it is.
And who is doing it? See, the context of big data is such a misused thing. People start doing a little bit of social media analytics or sentiments and they say, we are doing big data.
Yeah.
Real big data is knowing, finding a needle in a haystack. And that itself keeps changing, right? So, yeah, there's a lot of misconception about missed data. A lot of people call themselves, you know, data analysts, data scientists. Understanding data and making sense out of it is a business skill. And there are multiple things that have been done for ages in, on competing with data, competing with analytics. So my quote is in that context that you really need to use data analytics as a competitive business advantage, as a marketing business advantage, not just as a good thing that you store in your infrastructure.
Yeah, and not as a to-do on the checklist.
Yeah, no. It has to be actioned. It has to be actioned.
Fantastic. I think that should be a wrap.
Thank you
so much, Arvind. I really, really appreciate your time and the effort that you put in. I know you've not been well today.
That's okay. I enjoyed it.
Thank you so much. So, just a small memento, Arvind, for you.
Thank you very much.
Hopefully, this will go on this trophy wall.
Absolutely. And, I wish you a success that this leap with Jatin Modi becomes as popular as coffee with XYZ.
Catch me in a conversation with Kanika Mittal as she lends a new perspective to influencer marketing campaigns and their implementation to make a real impact for your brand.